Good morning. Welcome. Glad you're here. It's a great day to worship our Lord. Couple quick announcements. On the bottom right of your bulletin is a little tearaway sheet for you to sign in. If you're new, we're thrilled that you're here. Welcome. Please fill that out. Put in the offering as our guest. If you want to update information or get involved in some way, please fill that out. Let us know what you're wanting to get involved in. Couple of quick reminders of things that are going on. Amazingly, in 3 weeks from tomorrow is the back to school rally. So school has come back. It's hard to believe already. Lots of items that are needed. Again, the goal is to supply kids with all of their school supplies that they need. So other churches are involved. We're the main church, so please look at this list and see what you can do to bring stuff to the church to help out with that. Also, there's a party that's going to be on August 11th. Summer's not over for the youth for our 7th through 12th grade. There's some items that are needed for that as well. It's in the back of your bulletin. We'd love to have you participate in that in any way that you can. Would you pray with me as we go to worship? Father, thank you for today. Thank you, Lord, that we could be here, we could be in your house, we could worship you. We would know that you are our Lord, that you are present this morning, and that we could worship you, we could glorify you, we could open our hearts and our spirits, our minds, our whole being, that we would be open to you, we would hear your call in our lives, we would experience the power of your presence in so many different ways. Lord, thank you. Thank you that we could be here. We praise your name. We love you, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand? Would you greet your neighbors and wish them Christ's love?
All right, folks, are you ready to sing some good old time songs this morning? One of my favorite ones for the all you basses out there. We've got this first song up, Wonderful Grace of Jesus. Here we go.
Wonderful Grace of Jesus, greater than all. Breathe. marvelous grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea, higher than the mountains, burning like a thousand, cultivation grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgressions, greater far than all. Grace of Jesus, reaching the most defiled, by its transforming power, making you God's dear child, purchasing peace and heaven for all eternity, and the wonderful grace of Jesus, grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgressions, greater far than all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus, praise his name.
Wow, that's a good one. How many basses out there? Put your hand up if you're a bass. Any bass? No bass? One. What? Two. Two bass. You're ashamed, aren't you? It's okay to be a bass. I know they try to do everything so high that you can't sing it, but that's one of your songs right there we just got through with. We're going to be talking today about Jesus and his love for us in Psalm 25. So I thought it'd be appropriate for us to sing Jesus Loves Even Me.
I am so glad that our Father in heaven tells of his love in the book he has given. Wonderful things in the Bible I see. This is the dearest that Jesus loves me. I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me.
Loves me. I am so
For his name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd.
As we turn to the Lord in prayer, I want to read a couple of cards. First is from the family of Eloise Hahn. Thank you, FBC family, for showing us your love during the past few weeks. We appreciate the flowers, your loving words, and kind hugs. Although many of you did not know our loved one, we felt the prayers extended to our Lord for our family. Thanks again, the family of Eloise Hahn. And then a card from Joni. Dear Alexandria Church family, words cannot express the depth of my gratitude for your kindness in the form of gifts, flowers, and cards of encouragement. During this unexpected season of our lives, we are thankful to have a church family to walk through the valley with us. We know we will see the goodness of God on the other side. Blessings from Joni Killian. Also, not a card, but a text message. New way to send a card. From Larry Savage, just thanking everyone for their visits, their cards, and their prayers during his time in the hospital. And he's expected to come home this week, so continued prayers for Larry as well. Also, if you'd remember Phil Chastain in prayer, Phil is in the hospital in Marion, going to have some tests done tomorrow. So if you would remember Phil in your prayers as well, that would be greatly appreciated. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you. We thank you again, Lord, that we could be here in your house. We could worship you. We could cry out to you in our needs. We could cry out with thanks. And so, Lord, as we worship you, as we worship you this morning, help us to call out your name to make known our requests. We thank you, Lord, that you've promised us that you will respond, that you hear our cries, you hear our calls, you hear our groanings, our whispers, that you are fully aware of our needs. There's nothing that happens that you don't know about. There are no surprises. And so help us, Lord, to draw closer to you, knowing that you seek our best. We don't understand all that happens in our lives. We don't get it all. But there's a plan. And it's a plan for good to happen. And so help us to trust in you, to trust in that plan that you've set before us. Lord, we lift up those who are struggling. Remember Joni and Norma as they move through therapy with their cancer. We pray, Lord, that you would bring healing to their bodies. You would strengthen them, encourage them, help them through this process, Lord, that they would experience your power and your grace. For Phil, as he's in the hospital awaiting tests tomorrow, we pray, Lord, that you would take away any anxiety, any fear, that you'd replace it with the power of your presence, the peace that overwhelms us during difficult times. We continue to lift up Larry in prayer for continued healing for his body, for strength, for encouragement, the courage to keep moving forward. We thank you, Jesus, for whatever is going on in our lives where we have that access to your throne room, that we could praise you, we could celebrate, we can give thanks. And so help us, Lord, in every moment, every season in our lives, that we would turn to you and we would know that you are there, that you have never failed us, you will not forsake us, but that your promises are true and good for all times. Lord, we thank you for hope. Hope that you'll always be with us. Hope that when we have you and when we have your hope, that we will never be disappointed because good will ultimately come through. Pray, Lord, for Heidi as she sings this morning, that you would lift up her voice. You'd help her to lead us further into worship. And as we prepare for an offering, that during this time of offering, it would be a time of celebration, a time where we can give back to your kingdom because you've so richly blessed us, that the offering that is received would be used to further your kingdom in whatever way that you lead us. Lord, help us in all that we do, that we would worship you, we would be guided by you, we would celebrate you, and always we would give you the honor and the glory. We pray in Christ's precious name. Amen.
My soul it aches and I've nowhere to go. Help me, God. In this dark hour I know only the power that made the stars can mend my heart. Oh, I've tried on my own, but I'm not that strong. You're all I've got. You're all I've got. Help me, God. Sometimes people leave, and I can grieve, 'cause life's not always fair. Help me to hold on. Though I can't see you, I believe you're there. I know you're there. In this dark hour, I know only the power that made the stars can mend my heart. Oh, I've tried on my own, but I'm not that strong. You're all I've got. You're all I've got. Help me, God. Strong, you're all I've got. You're all I've got. Help me, God. Help me, God. Help me.
Have you ever felt like life was like riding a big, massive, never-ending roller coaster? We talk about the seasons of life, and that means we have those good seasons, those times when we seem to be on a winning streak, everything seems to work out. And sometimes after that happens, without warning, it seems that the bottom drops out and we can't win. Something goes wrong, and so we try to change things up in our lives. Maybe we change our schedules, or we find a new job, or we even change the routine of how we get dressed in the morning. We do everything we can so that something is going to kick in and make a change for us. And I've felt that way at times, and I think most of us have been there. Even in the midst of a single day, you can be on that roller coaster ride. It can start off great. You ever hold that cup of coffee in your hand or do something and spill it? The day seems to start to go downhill. You forget about it. The day starts to go well. Then you get a flat tire. Something goes wrong. It seems to be this up and down kind of day. It happens. Well, today we're going to look at a psalm in which David seemed to be on a roller coaster ride of his faith. And it impacted him in all ways. It impacted him spiritually, emotionally, mentally, and physically. And we're going to look at Psalm 25. I'm going to take us through various parts of it, and we'll see some of his roller coaster ride. The psalm starts out this way. He says, "To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me." David starts out praising God. He's reaffirming his trust in the Lord. It's you, O Lord, it's you only that I lift up my soul to. It's only to God that David gives praise and prayer to. He continues by reminding God, it's only in you, Lord, that I trust. I trust in you. I trust in the plan that you have for me. Because, Lord, there's no other way for me to worship. My hope, my eyes, my trust, my heart, they're all given to you, Lord. And because David worships only the Lord, he can make these requests. Lord, don't let me be put to shame. Don't let my enemies exult over me. Don't let them celebrate my destruction. It's a deep prayer. It's a deep petition to God. There may even be a little doubt for David. Lord, don't let this happen. Don't let it happen, Lord. And then in the next verse, David affirms that this won't happen. It's part of the roller coaster ride of faith. He said, indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Do you hear the confidence in David? None who wait for you shall be put to shame. In the previous verse, it was a request. It was a prayer. Lord, don't let me be put to shame. But now it's changed. Now it's whoever trusts in you, Lord, we will not be put to shame. It's like David saying, Nobody who waits for the Lord, nobody who says the Lord is mine will be put to shame. I believe. I trust in the power and in the strength of the Lord. Don't we go through our rough patches too? Do you ever doubt a little? You don't have to raise your hand. You ever doubt? Not total doubt, just a little wondering. God, can you really heal me? God, can you really give me the strength I need? Lord, are you really going to provide that job that I want? Lord, can you really help my child? We ask, but sometimes we still aren't really sure God can or will give us the answer we hope for. And while we may not get what we hope for, David's affirming in the end that we're not going to be put to shame. You'll be lifted up. And he says, and those who ultimately pursue you will not be put to shame. But those who are going in the other direction, they will be. Part of the roller coaster ride we have. We kind of go up and down, even in our faith, even in our prayers, we sometimes wonder a little bit. It's important to understand that in this psalm, three times David said, I will wait for the Lord. He said it here in verse 3, none who wait for you. He's referring to himself as well. But he also said it again in verse 5 and in verse 21. He said, for you I wait all the day long. In verse 21, for I wait for you. How many times have you placed your trust in God? How many times have you made a request to God? You believed in that request, in that prayer. I believe 100% God could do what I've asked. You believed. But then, you get an idea. God, hold on a minute. I've got a better plan. I know I made a request. Lord, put that on hold. Because I think I want to do what I think is better for me than what you can do for me. Have you ever done that? You ever pray to God, and no sooner have you got it out, you've got a new idea. Wait a minute. Whoa. I have a better plan. Because what I want isn't to wait on the Lord. Who really wants to wait on the Lord? 1,000 years is like nothing to God. 5 minutes is like 1,000 years to me. I want immediate gratification. I want what I want, and I want it now. So I'm going to take control. I don't want to wait on the Lord. Who wants to wait on the Lord? Anyone really want to wait 5 minutes? I don't. 10 seconds might be a long time. So I want what I want, and I want it now. And most of us are that way. But David's reminding us 3 times in the psalm, I will wait on the Lord. He's being pursued. He's got enemies around him. Some believe that this is his son Absalom who is rebelling against him. We don't really know the whole context of this. We make our request known to God, and then we want God to act like that magical genie and give us what we want. But we know that's not how it works, but yet we do it anyways. So a lesson we can learn from David in the psalm is to wait on the Lord, to learn how to slow down and to wait for the Lord. It doesn't mean you stop asking. It doesn't mean you stop praying. You keep asking until you believe you have been given an answer. And it can be a little tricky because we want to hear from the Lord. You want to hear, yo, Michael, this is what I want you to do. You don't always hear it that way. Sometimes you might hear it from a friend. A friend might give you the answer. You might hear it in a song. You might hear it in a sermon. You might get the answer from some other person, from reading scripture, some other way that you get it. But you've got to be open. And that's part of that waiting on the Lord, waiting for the answer. God will answer. He will answer. But he will answer in the way he chooses. And we need to be alert and attentive so that we could hear God when we get his answer. And so now David reaffirms his faith in God. And he says, lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Lead me, Lord. Lead me in your truth. Not my truth, but lead me in your truth. Teach me, Lord. For you're the God. You're my hope. You're my salvation. And again, for you, I wait all the day long. And that leads David to make another request in verses 6 and 7. He wrote, remember your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Twice he reminds God, and I love this, Lord, would you remember? I don't think God forgets. But there are certain things he causes himself to forget. We'll get there. David asks God, remember your mercy, Lord. Remember your constant love. Remember your steady love. Remember your never-ending love. That's what that steadfast love is about. They've been there forever. It will continue forever. But now David's struggling again. He's back on that roller coaster. And he asks God not to remember the sins from his youth. Have you ever had that? I don't know about you. I mean, I'm a pastor, so I've led a pretty perfect life. I'm glad you're laughing, because it hasn't been. I'm a sinner among sinners. But have you ever been reminded of your sins of the past? Not the sins from 5 minutes ago, but a sin from a year ago, 2 years ago, 10 years ago, 40 years ago. All of a sudden, you're not thinking about it. You're not thinking, sitting there thinking, I wonder what sins I can remember. It just pops out of nowhere. Or you're watching a TV program, or you're talking to someone, or something happens, and boom, it just comes and it smacks you. It's like, whoa, man. And it hits you so suddenly. It hits you like the flu. No warning. And it takes over. Or maybe for you it happens at night. You get in bed. It's all quiet. You want to go to sleep. but your brain won't go to sleep. And the mind is going and going and going. And sometimes you're dredging up your own sins. You're dredging up, oh man, if I had only done this. Oh, why didn't I do this? Oh, if I... And you go on and on about yourself. And you beat yourself up. Some stuff that you can't let go. David knows. He knows God is gracious. He knows God is loving and forgiving. He's been down this road before. He's a man after God's own heart. But during this dark time, this roller coaster ride in his life, he's being reminded of his sinfulness. And so he prays, Lord, take these sins away from me. According to your faithful love, your constant love, blot out my transgressions. Lord, reassure me. Grant to me confidence that I'm really forgiven because I'm struggling. It's like that song that we sang before. Jesus loves me. And I love that line in that song. Jesus, because we could say, when we're struggling, I could say, oh, well, Jesus loves you. Oh, he loves you. He even loves the balcony. But there's that line in that song that says, Jesus loves even me, even sinful Michael. Jesus loves me. And that's what we have to hold on to. Jesus, it's not, oh, Jesus loves me, yeah, yeah. No, Jesus loves even me. Two other times in the psalm, it shows David's roller coaster. Two other times in the psalm, he comes back to the issue of his own sins. We see it in verse 7. You see it in verse 11 and in verse 18. He said, for your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. And in verse 18, consider my affliction and my trouble and forgive all my sins. There's so much guilt flowing through David, possibly because of his situation. And yet he should know, as we talked about a few weeks ago, from Psalm 51, after his affair with Bathsheba, he went to God and said, Lord, cleanse me. Make me whiter than snow. And so he knew God could forgive him. And yet he goes back on this roller coaster. He's now not on this high. He's on a low. Lord, I can't get over all that I've done. Forgive me. Sometimes we get that way. Sometimes we just think, man, I've done some stuff that's just terrible. And I can't get over it, and the Lord won't forgive me. And friends, you need to understand, if Jesus is your Lord and Savior, he's forgiven you. We can point out to so many scriptures, and I'm going to give you five. It's so important to really know that he does love you, and he does forgive you. One of my favorites is from 1 John 1:9, when John says, if we confess, what's the key word in that whole scripture? If, because we don't want to confess. We don't want to admit. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and he is just, and he will forgive us of our sins, and not only forgive us, but he will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And in Isaiah, God says, I am he who blots out your transgressions, not for your sake, but for his sake. He's going to blot it out, and I will not remember your sins. Remember I said God could cause himself to forget? God looks at, this is already in here, someone's ready for me. God looks at your sins, he remembers them no more. Didn't want to hit you because I might hit Joni. Nice fielding. God remembers your sins no more. Is that not amazing or what? Think about it. He causes himself to forget your sins. Then we can go on. David tells us in Psalm 103, as far as the east is from the west, so far has God removed our transgressions from us. Daniel, we read, the Lord our God is merciful and forgiving, even though we have rebelled against him, he still forgives us. And the last one, and Paul tells us in Ephesians 1, in him, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace. That is great news, friends. That is great news. We need to believe it is real and true. God does forgive us. If not, then think about the absurdity of God sending his son to die for us. Why would he send his son to die for us if he's not going to forgive us? That would be totally absurd. Maybe the issue is that you're really struggling to forgive yourself for something you did. So many of us have been there on that one too. We believe God forgave us, but our real struggle is holding on to our sinfulness and not letting it go and trusting that God really has forgiven me and I need to forgive me and I need to let go of it. Eventually, David turns back on that roller coaster ride and falls into major despair. I mean, it's this up and down. Listen to his words to God. Listen to the struggle. In verse 16, turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. The troubles of my heart are enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses. Consider my affliction and my trouble, and forgive all my sins. Consider how many are my foes, and with what violent hatred they hate me. Do you see this roller coaster ride he's on? He's praising God. He's giving God thanks for the salvation. It's this up and down and up and down. And now he's in major despair. You get the sense that David is overwhelmed. There's fear. There's anxiety. He's calling on God for protection. He's afflicted. He's surrounded by his enemy. He's in trouble, and David is calling on God. Do you guys ever have that too? Maybe you don't have someone pursuing you. Maybe there's some enemy who's not chasing you down, but in the course of a day, it just seems to change, and you're struggling, and you can't get it figured out, and you feel lonely. Sometimes when you're struggling, you could be in a crowd, and you feel lonely. You feel afflicted. You feel like the world is pressing in on you. You can't catch your breath. And you go back to God again. Lord, okay, what else have I done? Forgive. Is there a sin that I've done? And that's where David went again in verse 18. Forgive my sins again, Lord. Let me go back over it again. There's people against me. There's situations against me. Everything seems to be against me. And David's spirit is just in anguish. It's like he's taking two steps forward and three backwards. It's the third time David has asked for forgiveness. Maybe we're holding on to a sin as well when we feel we're going through that. It's, Lord, take away my sins again. Something is going on for me, Lord. And David cries out, oh, guard my soul. Deliver me. Let me not be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Again, there's David's willingness to wait for the Lord. He prays, Lord, guard my soul. That's what verse 20 is. Oh, guard my soul and deliver me. Don't guard my mind. Don't guard my body. But guard my soul. David wants his relationship with God to be right. That's what's most important to him. So in the midst of my troubles, while my enemy is pursuing me, while the bills are adding up, while the kids are struggling, while my health is worsening, while my job is ending, Lord, guard my soul. Protect me.
help me to be right with you, because if I'm right with you, it doesn't matter what else happens. Because I've got you. And I know I'm good because I've got you. Everything else can crumble. I could lose my job, I could lose my health, I could lose whatever. But if I have you, I'm good. Have you ever known people who will turn away from God in the tough times? Things don't go their way. Life makes that U-turn, that life was good, and all of a sudden you go on that losing streak and nothing seems to go right. And you find people, well, the church just didn't do what I needed them to do. God just bailed out on me. God did this. And they kind of turn. They go back the other way. And they skip the church. They skip God. But David's saying, Lord, guard my soul. Because I want a right relationship with you. And sometimes the first prayer that we have when the bad things happen is, Lord, fix it. I don't want to wait on you, Lord. Just fix it. Get it done. And if you get it done, don't we kind of make this a conditional? I know you won't admit to it. I'll admit to it. It's all conditional. Lord, if you do this for me, oh man, I'll come and I'll praise you. I'll tell the whole world about you. Oh, if you fix this problem in my life, you know what, Lord, I'll give you more money. Oh, Lord, I'll start to serve in the church. Lord, you'll never not see me in church. I'll be there on Sundays. I'll be there on Wednesdays. I'll be there on Tuesdays when there's nothing going on. I'll just be there to guard the door. I'll just be there. Don't we kind of make it a little bit conditional? If you do this for me, I'll do this for you. But it's, Lord, just guard my soul. Lord, just help me to know that you're with me. And that's all I need. Doesn't matter if everything else crumbles. That's all I want. Is I want you. I want that relationship. And yet God's promised us that he's never going to fail us. He's never going to forsake us. He's never going to abandon us. He's not going to condemn us because he sent his son for us. So guard my soul. Protect me from my enemies, which includes myself. Because sometimes we're our own worst enemy, aren't we? To go all the way back to verse 8, David had said, good and upright is the Lord. Therefore he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. David knows God is good. God is merciful. God is just. God cannot stand to look at sin. And yet because God is good, God can forgive us of our sin. You see, it is so important to be humble and to practice humility. Because God could lead the humble. He could teach the humble. But when you're not humble, when you're arrogant, it's hard to learn. Have you ever tried to teach someone who knows it all? It's pretty hard, isn't it? After all, they know it all. You can't teach them. The humble person is the willing learner. How often do we seek to learn from others? How often are we willing to admit that we don't have all the answers? I love what David said in this about being humble, because David is the king. He's the king of Israel. He is the king of the most powerful nation in their whole area, probably in the world as far as they knew. And yet David's saying, you know what? You lead the humble in what is right, and I need to be humble so I could learn to learn to be right. So grant to me, Lord, grant to me your wisdom. Grant to me your understanding so that I can better worship and honor you, because ultimately at the end, I want you to guard my soul, because I'm going to practice this humility. So if we move to the final two verses, David asked, "May integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you." Integrity and uprightness. In your final days, when people look back at you, when they look back at me, when someone talks about you, oh, we might say, oh, well, you know, he was this or she was that. Oh, you know, they were great at this or great at this. But for someone to look back and say, you know, they walked with God. They were a person of integrity. They were an upright person. They were good, noble, righteous. If someone can describe you with those words, then whatever else you have accomplished in life is all girded up because you were a righteous person, because you lived a life of integrity. That is so vital in our lives. Pastor and writer A.W. Tozer, great writer, he wrote this: "An infinite God can give all of himself to each of his children. He does not distribute himself that each may have a part, but to each one he gives all of himself fully as if there were no others." I love that. God just doesn't say, "Oh, I'm going to give a little piece to you, little piece to you, little piece to you." God says, "No, there's only one of you." That's what I said last week. God loves you like there was only one to love, and that was you. And he gives all of himself to you. And finally, David's words to the Lord, his final words, is a prayer. Not for himself, but it's ultimately for the nation. He says, "Redeem Israel, O God, out of all his troubles." Finally, Dave, the whole psalm has been about David. "Lord, protect me. Lord, guard my soul. Help me to wait for you. Help me to be humble so that I can get your wisdom and your understanding. Help me on this journey that I'm on." But now, and this is why people think this is David's son, his pride and joy, Absalom, who is now revolting and coming after his father and after his kingdom. "Whatever troubles our nation has, Lord, help us. Redeem the nation." Psalm 25 is a roller coaster ride of faith. David reminds us of our own journey. Because so many times in our own journey, we kind of go through that roller coaster. We might do it in one day. We might do it over seasons. We kind of go up and down. We pray sometimes doubting. But the call is to pray with confidence. The call is to have the confidence in God where we can say, "Lord, guard my soul. Guard my soul. This is all I have. Protect me." So as we end, know that God loves you. It's when David asked for forgiveness 3 times. Be reminded that God loves you, has sent his son for you, and has forgiven you. He created you. He called you. You are his child who is holy and dearly loved. Even in the ups and downs of life, God has promised us, if we wait on the Lord, if we can wait on him, we will experience the power of the Lord. But you need to wait on the Lord, and you will gain his power and his strength. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you. Thank you, Lord, for David. In the midst of this psalm and this roller coaster ride of faith that he had, the struggles that he had of sometimes not being sure of what was going on and being chased and pursued, and Lord, ultimately, the call was for him to follow you and to wait for you, that you would guard his soul. Lord, help us to know that you have forgiven us. Whatever it is that goes on in our lives, our own struggles, that you forgive us. because we have you, we have Jesus. And so, Lord, strengthen us. Strengthen us for the days ahead when we go through those seasons of life in which it seems like our enemies are chasing us down. But we know when we have you, we would have everything. And we know you love us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we prepare for our final song this morning, know that God does love you. And if you struggle with that, if you say, you know, Lord, I need you. I need to embrace the Lord for the first time, or you need prayer for something going on in your life, I'd encourage you to come forward. We could pray together. We could call on the Lord for whatever's going on. And if it's to join this church, come forward. We'll celebrate the work of Christ in your life. George.
Would you please stand and sing with us?
Great song to walk out to. Remember how he loves you and me. Even me, he loves. Thanks for being here, that we could worship together. Go out this week. Show the world who Christ is. Demonstrate his love and his grace. Paul, would you pray?
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for all that you do for us each day. We thank you for the sermon Michael gave us today. Lord, we know that you're with us on this roller coaster ride, the ups and the downs, and you are the ultimate forgiver. Lord, be with us each day. In your name we pray. Amen.